Is Al having the worst week of his life? Drama in sensitive skin over on BBC Two now.
Join me later tonight with Michael Portillo and Diane Abbott for our This Week Christmas special. We'll be reviewing the political year, and what a year, with Piers Morgan, Sandra Howard, John Stewart from America, and our very own pub landlord, Al Murray. That's This Week, tonight. Hey, mine's a pint.
This is BBC One in the South. Now the 10 o'clock news with George Alagiah and Joe Kent.
Iraqis vote for their first fully fledged parliament in a generation. Polls stayed open for longer to cope with a bigger turnout than expected. There were celebrations as the insurgents failed to make their mark. We'll be asking whether the election is the new beginning Iraqis have been waiting for. Also tonight, released early from jail and on probation, Damien Hansen is found guilty of murdering a city banker and terrorizing his family. The huge growth in speed cameras is over, despite new evidence that they save lives. And a change of colours for Roy Keane. Celtics fans are delighted, but what about his new teammates?
I'm sure they'll love me.
In the South, bludgeoned to death by her stepfather, Charlotte Lewis's killer is told he'll serve at least 26 years for her murder. And the search is on for an armed robber who struck five times.
Good evening. Iraqis turned out in large numbers today to vote for a parliament that will see a fully established democratic government brought to the country for the first time most people can remember. Polling stations had to stay open for an extra hour to cope with the queues. Security has been tight across the country. There were a few reports of violence, but voting has been largely peaceful. Election organizers say the high turnout was seen right across Iraq, in the Shia areas of the south, in the Kurdish north, and amongst the Sunni population, which largely boycotted elections in January, but turned out in force this time. More than 15 million Iraqis were registered to vote in today's poll, and the new parliament will serve a four-year term. There are 275 seats available, and a quarter of the parliament must be made up of women. From Baghdad, our World Affairs editor John Simpson reports.
The first thing was to ensure the election passed off relatively peacefully. And once again, the tactic of closing down every single town and city throughout Iraq for two whole days seemed to work. Yet it was so drastic that it simply emphasized how far you have to go in order to keep down the level of violence here. And a lockdown as extensive as this is unthinkable for any real length of time. Iraqis turned out in such numbers to vote because most people here, from whatever background, seem to believe it's the best thing they can do as individuals to bring about peace. Yet their precise aims are often very different. Quite a few think voting in a strong Iraqi government is the best way to get rid of the American troops in their country.
Therefore, I hope they leave us. That's all.
Others want a government to include Sunnis in the hope of undercutting the Sunni insurgency.
We see many sharing between Arab Shia, Arab Sunni, Arab Kurdish, and we see more people coming to here to do the voting for this election. We are happy for that.
Most of all, though, they just want an end to insecurity and fear.
It's very important because we must vote to save our country from all the dangers and the wars which are going on now.
The ballot's the size of a newspaper because there are so many parties. But the main groups will probably end up sharing power. The election rules are specifically designed to make sure that the Shiite majority, with the help of the Kurds, don't carve everything up between them. That's what happened last time because Sunnis stayed away from the polls. This time should be better. Everything is going to depend now on how quickly the votes that are registered can be translated into strong, effective government. If the negotiations on a new coalition drag out endlessly as they did before, it's not going to work. What Iraqis want is an effective government, and they want it now.
So that's why they've turned out in sizable numbers right across Iraq.
in the Shiite heartlands, where the new power lies because they're the majority, in the Kurdish north, where they're virtually independent of Baghdad, and in Sunni areas like Saddam Hussein's own province, where they've missed out on power. Most people assume the current Prime Minister, Ibrahim Jaafari, will now share the government with Sunnis as well as Kurds. His predecessor, Iyad Alawi, was discredited, but by talking tough, he's won new support. Neither of the two interim governments Iraq has had since Saddam's fall has been particularly impressive. Now we'll see if getting the Sunnis on board can bring about a peaceful Iraq.
And we can talk to John Simpson now in Baghdad. John, the vote's gone well, but will it produce the kind of effective government you were talking about in your report just now?
Well, there are obviously going to be changes pretty quickly. I think we can expect that there's a good chance that Dr. Jaafari, the present Prime Minister, will be shoved aside. His government hasn't been very effective. Somebody will take his place. Possibly there'll be some support for Iyad Alawi, the American and British favourite, really. But I don't think he'll come back and be a top figure, but it must be possible that he'll be brought into a coalition. The problem really is in bringing in the Sunnis, because any leading Sunni politician will know how essential it is to get people like him into the government, and he'll drive a very, very hard bargain. And we'll be back in that dreadful period of 3 months in the spring where we couldn't have a government because people couldn't simply agree on the shape of the new government. Too many people were asking for too much. And so this success, because it is a big success here, would then dissipate because it wouldn't lead to precisely the kind of government that people faced up to the threat of voting and came out and demanded.
John, thank you. A convicted robber freed early from prison and on probation has been found guilty of murdering a wealthy city banker. 24-year-old Damien Hansen stabbed John Monckton in front of his wife and daughter in November last year. The jury is still considering its verdict on Hansen's accomplice. He's admitted robbery but denies murder and attempted murder. Luisa Baldini reports.
Damien Hansen had been released from prison early, just 3 months before he struck again. Motivated by sheer greed, it was in this affluent area of Chelsea in London that he decided to pick his target. With him was Elliot White, seen here on the right. They'd been friends since primary school, and together they planned to rob this multi-million pound. It was Hansen who wreaked an appalling episode of violence, the court heard. In the house was John Monckton, a banker with Legal & General, his wife Omira, and one of their daughters.
Mr. Monckton returned home here at about 7 p.m. as his wife was giving their daughter a bath. Then the doorbell rang. Through the spy hole, the Monctons could see there was a postman with a parcel. And as John Monckton opened the door, the two robbers burst in.
First, Mrs. Monckton was stabbed with such force that her rib shattered. Then Mr. Monckton was knifed 8 times. He died soon after. From upstairs, their 9-year-old daughter Isabel saw part of the attack. She came down to find her parents covered in blood and dialed 999. The two robbers stole £4,500 worth of jewellery, though Hansen later told White he was disappointed with the value. The jury were told Damien Hansen was on probation and living at this bail hostel in South London after being released early from prison just 12 weeks before. In fact, the jury heard the whole of his criminal history. How in July 1995, age 14, Hansen had committed burglary. Then 3 months later, in October, he mugged and stabbed a teenager. In June 1996, he was convicted for attempted burglary. And in August 97, he committed robbery and attempted murder. He was jailed for 12 years and released after 7 in August last year. Nicknamed Omen, Hansen was obsessed with the rich. In his bedroom, he kept newspaper lists on the wealthiest people in Britain and articles on diamonds. Also found was a card for this shop on the King's Road, where Mrs. Monckton had been shopping earlier that year.
Hansen's defence was that he was never even in Chelsea the night of the murder, but the jury simply didn't believe him. And so tonight he's behind bars for the murder of John Monckton, a man described as gentle and thoughtful, a person of the utmost integrity and kindness. Luisa Baldini, BBC News, at the Old Bailey.
President Bush has tonight accepted calls for a new law banning the cruel, inhumane and degrading treatment of terrorist suspects being held in US custody. The measure was proposed by the Republican Senator John McCain, a former prisoner of war who was tortured in Vietnam. The White House had originally wanted CIA interrogators to be exempt. And we can talk to our correspondent Matt Fry, who's in Washington. Matt, a lot of people are going to say this is something of a climb down.
Absolutely, George, especially for Dick Cheney, the vice president, who, believe it or not, had personally campaigned against this bill. And at one stage, there was the prospect that this president, who had never before used his presidential veto, might use it for the first time to veto a bill that explicitly banned the use of torture. I mean, all this was politically very damaging, and of course it came in the context of that rather grim vocabulary that people here have had to get used to, of black sites, the secret CIA detention centers supposedly existing in Eastern Europe, waterboarding, a kind of torture, and of course extraordinary renditions. So the political pressure has mounted, and finally President Bush listened to Senator McCain, who himself had been the subject of torture, and who told him, listen, it doesn't work morally, it's reprehensible, and it doesn't work in terms of getting information, so drop it. And they finally listened to him.
All right, Matt, thank you. Tony Blair says a deal on a new EU budget is still hanging in the balance. The leaders of all 25 European Union states have arrived in Brussels tonight in a final effort to reach a deal this year. Mr. Blair's proposals have run into strong opposition, especially from the French. Our Europe editor, Mark Mardell, is in Brussels. Mark.
It would be wrong to say that the mood here is one of optimism, but it does seem in the last half an hour or so, leaders have accepted they've just got to do a deal this weekend. The alternative is too horrible to contemplate. The presidents and prime ministers and their foreign ministers too, of 25 countries slowly come together for what's called a family photo. It's a family that got very much bigger last year, and the question now is who pays for that expansion. Quietly slipping in the middle, the man who's meant to find the answer and who many think should come up with more cash himself.
Look, it's going to be very tough and very difficult. I think it's as well to be frank about that right at the outset. And it hangs very much in the balance.
He was straight into a meeting with the man who may cause him the most problems. France's President Jacques Chirac told him straight off there had to be a permanent reduction of the British rebate. Although Mr. Blair's people said it was a good meeting, and Mr. Chirac said it was a very good meeting, it must have been awkward. And when the polls arrived, the body language again spoke volumes. They feel Mr. Blair's first offer, taking money off the table, was damaging. The second, putting some of it back, was an insulting bribe.
We do not have much choice as to say to such proposal or as it is right now on the table, or to say no.
Of course, everybody here is haggling and charming to try to get the best deal for their country, but there are real worries about the European Union itself. It's been a pretty dreadful, crisis-ridden year for the EU, and there's rather a mood that a failure here would just be too much.
It is about coherence and credibility. Are we credible when we say we want an enlarged Europe to work?
At one time, the British had expected the talking to go on into the small hours, but after a dinner where Europe's leaders were served Welsh white wine, they began to emerge.
How were the budget discussions?
The budget discussion was blunt, and I was not surprised, because this was the first round, and now we start the negotiations. There seems to be huge differences.
Italy's Silvio Berlusconi showed irritation as his car failed to show up after the dinner. Like him, Europe's leaders are growing impatient with waiting and waiting for the British to come up with an acceptable offer.
But now it seems quite a few leaders have accepted the British argument that if there isn't a deal in the next couple of days, then there won't be one at all next year, and that would mean the Parliament annually setting the budget, and they're really frightened by that. George.
Mark, thank you. Well, as we've heard, one of the big sticking points over the new EU budget is a common agriculture policy. Britain says it won't agree a deal unless there is at least the possibility of reforms to the system of farm subsidies. Last year, the EU budget amounted to £70 billion. Of that, £31 billion, that's 43%, went on agriculture alone. But less than £3 billion went to UK farmers, whereas farmers in France received more than double that. From Normandy, Caroline Wyatt reports.
It's dawn, and French farmer Stéphane Lemonnier is preparing for another long day. which starts with milking his herd of 70 dairy cows. He's a staunch defender of Europe's farming subsidies. They make up 40% of his income, without which, Stefan says, his business couldn't survive.
Why should the European taxpayer be subsidizing farming? Why should Europe be giving French farmers a quarter of that budget?
C'est simple, si vous voulez encore manger demain.
It's simple. If you want to eat tomorrow, then we need that 25% of the subsidies. If we don't get them, we'll have to stop producing. And I think we do a noble job. We feed the people.
And the French people support the farmers in return, viewing them not just as guardians of the land, but of a specifically French way of life, with food at the heart of the culture. Farm reform, a hugely sensitive issue.
Yet there are some signs that the consensus among French farmers against any further reform to farming subsidies is beginning to crumble, at least a little, because the biggest subsidies go to the biggest landowners and often the biggest businesses. And French smallholders say that has to change.
At the moment, with the amount of subsidies, there is at least half which is for nothing. It's just waste of money, because big farmers are mainly investing in property market, and they are not investing in farming, and there is no sense to give money for this farmer.
But in the French countryside, that's still a minority view, giving President Chirac little reason to back down now, in the twilight of a long career built on defending his nation's farmers. Caroline Boyard, BBC News, Normandy.
The growth in the number of speed cameras on our roads is set to slow down as money from fines is diverted into other road safety measures. The government has decided to change its policy in England and Wales. It follows criticism from motorists that cameras were being used to raise money. Here's our transport correspondent, Tom Simons.
It still tragically happens, but our roads have slowly become the safest in Europe. The double flash drivers have learnt to dread has helped reduce road deaths to just over 3,000 last year. It doesn't mean speed cameras are popular, accepted maybe, not popular. Dozens are attacked and destroyed each year, but road safety bodies aren't in a hurry to get rid of them.
Where we put cameras at specific sites to deal with a specific problem, we see a significant reduction in the number of casualties, 44% right across all of our sites.
And the latest government research, published today, suggested where cameras are installed, speeding falls by 70%. Deaths and serious injuries can fall by up to 42%. Last year, £1 million in fines. Until now, money spent on more cameras. But that's going to change. In Lincolnshire, no new cameras were installed this year. They weren't needed. Other ways were found to reduce casualties. The government liked the idea and today decided all fines would be diverted from cameras to a wider variety of road safety measures. These signs let drivers know how fast they're going. No penalties are issued, but brakes are still applied.
It means the steady spread of speed cameras across Britain could now be halted, with some road safety authorities replacing their cameras altogether, with much softer ways of persuading drivers to slow down.
16-year-old Livia was killed by a speeding car. Her father's campaigned for better road safety, but he believes it's right to move away from relying on speed cameras.
They don't catch the drunk driver, they don't catch the drug driver, they don't catch aggressive driver, and above all, they don't have the flexibility and discretion of the road traffic police.
But the government insists this isn't the end of speed cameras. In fact, it's also relaxing the rules on where they can be erected. Today's new policy is a change in emphasis, an attempt to save lives without alienating drivers. Tom Simons, BBC News, Lincolnshire.
The man investigating the assassination of a former Lebanese Prime Minister, Rafiq Hariri, has urged the United Nations to maintain its pressure on Syria and speed up the inquiry. A report by the investigator Detlev Melis has already implicated Syrian officials in the plot to kill Mr. Hariri last February. Mr. Melis has been speaking to our Middle East editor, Jeremy Bowen, in New York.
Back in May, Detlev Melis left the state prosecutor's office in Berlin for the corridors of the UN and the streets of Beirut to head a murder inquiry that is exposing some of the darkest secrets in Lebanon and Syria. On the 14th of February this year, the former Prime Minister of Lebanon, Rafik Hariri, and 22 others were killed by a huge bomb in Beirut. Lebanon asked the UN to investigate. Detlev Meles spoke to the BBC at the UN in New York, where he's been briefing the Security Council. Do you have any idea so far who killed Rafik Hariri and why?
For us, it is pretty clear that, nothing of this size, nothing of that kind of assassination could have happened without the knowledge of the intelligence agencies, Lebanese and the Syrians, who were really very present in Lebanon at that time.
And getting cooperation from the Syrians is Melis's hardest job. They deny they were involved, but they're the UN's prime suspects.
We have a foot in the door, and that means that we will sooner or later be able to open up the door fully.
Do you think this door that you have your foot in is a door that is yielding to pressure? Or do you think that they're pushing back hard on the other side?
It's not easy. It wasn't easy to open it, and it won't be easy to open it further, and that's why some pressure will be needed.
Another car was bombed in Lebanon this week. It was the latest of a string of assassinations of Lebanese people who've criticized Syria. The victim, Gibran Tuwaini, a prominent newspaper editor, died with his bodyguard and driver. The mourners at the funeral, and many others in Lebanon, believe Syrian hitmen are still at work, even though Syria was forced to pull its troops out of their country after the Hariri assassination. Tonight, the Security Council is discussing another resolution to force Syria to cooperate with the inquiry. If it does not, it could eventually face sanctions. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, at the United Nations.
A baby has had a miraculous escape after being dropped from the window of a burning flat in New York. After fire broke out in her third floor apartment, the mother threw her one-month-old son out of the window and into the arms of a passerby below. The man said he caught the boy like a football. Mother and baby are both unharmed. The former Manchester United captain Roy Keane has signed for Celtic a month after dramatically leaving Old Trafford. Arriving at his new club, he said it had been a strange few weeks, but signing for Celtic was a great move for him. Our Scotland correspondent Andrew Castle reports.
He may have become surplus to requirements at Old Trafford, but in the East End of Glasgow, Roy Keane is king. He was mobbed by adoring Celtic supporters, for whom the former Manchester United star is still a world-class player despite his advancing years. Roy Keane had been courted by a host of English Premiership clubs and Real Madrid, but to the delight of all his new fans, by yesterday morning he'd opted to join Celtic.
I've not come up here on a PR trip or an ego trip or to unwind, far from it. I'm coming up here to win football matches and help the squad. You know, I'm very much, I feel a team player, despite other reports.
But his criticism of the playing abilities of some of his former colleagues at United has added to his formidable reputation.
You have a reputation for plain speaking, honest speaking. How do you think that will go down with your new teammates?
I'm sure they'll love me.
As the midfielder was getting acquainted with the press, the Celtic shop was already running off new shirts, which are the latest must-have for delighted fans.
Roy Keane has always wanted to end his playing career back here at Celtic Park, and now he's achieved that ambition following a successful conclusion to his contract negotiations.
Roy Keane's first Celtic match will be in the Scottish Cup away against Clyde, not quite the glamour tie he's been used to in the past. Andrew Castle, BBC News, Celtic Park.
And finally, tonight marks the end of an era for television news. Sir Trevor MacDonald bids farewell after a career spanning 32 years at ITN. Hugh Edwards went to see him to find out why he's leaving, what memories he'll take with him, and what he'll miss when he's gone.
He is, quite simply, one of the best-known faces and voices in Britain.
Good evening, good evening, good evening. At one point today, it looked as though...
And he's enjoyed huge popularity as a news presenter. We caught up with him as he prepared to leave the ITV newsroom for the last time, and as he reflected on his first appearance as a newscaster more than 20 years ago.
What I do remember is that I was terrified. And I think that terror lasted for many, many, many years. And it's only very recently that one got fairly accustomed to doing it. and I'm leaving.
Trevor was already an experienced correspondent. He'd covered stories in every part of the world, and he still believes passionately that news matters.
I think news is still desperately important to inform people in a well-balanced, fair and accurate way. I think it's also important because we do have to hold governments to account. And I think we also get the chance when we do the news to speak for those who can't speak for themselves.
What are the biggest programs you've done in terms of stories?
I've always enjoyed the traveling a great deal. And traveling around covering American presidential campaigns has always been tremendous fun. But of course, I did the first interview with Mandela when he was released. I interviewed Saddam Hussein, which whenever I see those images now of him in court, it always comes to mind. Journalists are very good at looking back with a great feeling of nostalgia, and I must confess I'm guilty of that too.
Britain's first black news presenter has collected a mountain of trophies. They all underline his special place in British television. He's not giving up broadcasting, but there'll be no more news.
Thank you. I think that there comes a time when you would like to move on and do something else, and it's always nice to be able to discern when you should make that time and when you should go. And I have had a great time, and it's time for someone else.
So Trevor McDonald there. We'll be back with the headlines in a few minutes, and on BBC News 24 tonight, the latest on those elections in Iraq with reports from around the country. But here on BBC One, it's time to join our news teams across the UK. Bye for now.
Very good evening to you. I'm Jo Kent. A man from Dorset has been jailed for life after admitting battering his stepdaughter to death and grievously injuring his wife. Paul Coles killed Charlotte Lewis in the family home at Southbourne. Investigations underway after it was revealed police received a call to the address but didn't force an entry. Chris Conaby reports.
Paul Coles attacked his stepdaughter, Charlotte Lewis, with a piece of wood, repeatedly hitting her about the head until she was unconscious. He then stripped her and sexually assaulted her before she died. Charlotte, a teacher from Exeter, was visiting home at the time so she could go and see her new baby nephew with relatives nearby. In the next bedroom, her mother, Nicola, was also attacked by Coles, again with a piece of wood. She received severe head injuries. Coles later admitted to the police that he had dark moments of fantasy involving women.
This particular incident where Charlotte has been attacked, not by a perfect stranger, but by her stepfather, somebody she really thought she could trust.
At midnight on the call from a distressed young woman. It must have been Charlotte, the court was told. She said, "He's hitting me." She gave the address and police arrived 7 minutes later. They knocked, there was no reply. The house appeared to be unoccupied and there was no sign of disturbance. Eventually, they decided not to force an entry. Dorset police haven't commented on that part of the case, other than to say certain aspects have been referred to the Independent Police Complaints Commission.
I just can't believe that this could happen to someone so lovely. I think it's an absolute shame that they don't have a capital punishment in this country. There's people like him who attack unprovokedly against children. They don't deserve to live.
Coles was sentenced to life. It will be 26 years before he can even be considered for release. Chris Conybeare for BBC South Today at Winchester Crown Court.
It's been 9 years in the planning, but a deal's finally been completed for a new super hospital on the site of the Queen Alexandra in Cosham. More than £200 million will be invested in new facilities, including a cancer centre, dedicated A&E for children and 27 operating theatres. Building work should take 3.5 years. Southern Waters told 6 staff members to take paid leave while it investigates standards of customer care. In October, the company revealed customers could be in line for compensation payments amounting to £2.5 million after mistakes were made with the way it handled some inquiries. The water regulator Ofwat and Serious Fraud Office were called in. A squad of detectives is hunting for an armed robber who struck 5 times in as many weeks in Bournemouth. On one occasion, the gunman had an accomplice. So far, no one's been hurt, but police are appealing for witnesses before someone is. Richard Drax reports.
It's 10 days ago at 9 p.m, and these two men are here to rob this store in Kinson. The man at the front is armed. You can see his handgun here. two female shop assistants are forced to hand over cash before the robbers escape. Mike McLaughlin was another victim. He'd also looked down the barrel of the same gun a few days before.
I do my normal day-to-day closing down thing, and this man come in with a gun, come to the till. He asked for money out the till. That's when I recognised the gun, gave him the money, and the bloke walked out calmly.
There have been five robberies in all over the past 5 weeks. The gunman has struck at this bookmaker's in Charminster early last month. 3 weeks later, he robbed this petrol station in Bere Wood. Then Mike was robbed here in Southbourne. A week later, the one-stop shop in Kinson was targeted. Finally, the gunman returned to Charminster to rob this wine store.
There's a lot of similarities. The size, the bulk of the nail, he's a stocky bloke. He's about 5'10" to 6 foot tall, white male. He's wearing a balaclava on all occasions. He produces a handgun and threatens the member of staff and gets away with a small amount of cash on each occasion.
Well, the police are looking to you, members of the public, for help. If you know who the men are, don't approach them, but call the police immediately. Richard Drax, BBC South Today, Bournemouth.
Eight shops at Bournemouth Castle Point Shopping Centre are to reopen next Tuesday after the complex was forced to close because of problems with the car park. Health and safety issues led to the car park being ruled unsafe at the start of the month. Following work, 1,000 spaces should be available from Tuesday. Dozens of families in Wokingham seeking financial help and support this Christmas are hoping funding can be found to save a local charity. Homestart has helped hundreds of parents and children over the last 10 years, as Joe Campbell reports.
Merry Christmas!
The families gathered here may have been in party mood, but however merry this Christmas, New Year looks set to be anything but happy for mums like Lisa Kirby, who've relied on Homestart's help here in Wokingham.
I actually was suffering with postnatal depression, and I just like needed to get out and about, meet new friends, and like start enjoying life again.
Bringing up babies is rarely easy, but all those here needed a little extra help, whether it's because of family disability or extra burdens, like the challenge of having twins or triplets.
And you see how many families have come here today and how many children have been able to enjoy this experience. And I know that our service is a lifeline to many families that are under stress.
Everyone was making sure the youngsters had a time to remember. But for the parents, the worry is what the new year holds. Joe Campbell, BBC Saturday in Wokingham.
Let's hope it's good news. On to the weather now. Tonight's weather picture is of the sun setting towards Littlehampton. Lovely sunset. That was taken by Graham Amos of East Preston. Thanks for that. On to the forecast then. Tonight, cloud thickening, a few spots of rain later. Temperatures falling to 6 Celsius. Tomorrow, cloudy, damp and windy to start, but brightening up later. Top temperature, 11 Celsius. That's all from us this evening. Our next updates are on BBC Breakfast tomorrow morning. Now though, it's good night from me. Back to George Alagiah in London.
And the main news tonight, Iraqis have turned out in large numbers to elect their first fully-fledged parliament for a generation. Polling stations had to stay open for longer to deal with bigger-than-expected queues. And a man let out of jail early on probation has been found guilty of murdering a wealthy banker. News tonight is getting underway over on BBC Two, but from all of us on the 10 o'clock team, good night.
Good evening. Provisional figures show it's been a very warm year, but over the next few days, temperatures on the fall. It's going to be much colder through Friday, and the colder weather set to last through the weekend. Out there right now, it's still relatively mild. We've got a huge blanket of cloud pushing in. That cloud also providing some wet weather across Scotland, and the damp conditions just dribbling southwards through the night into parts of northern England, North Wales and Northern Ireland. In the south, temperatures really holding up, but across northern Scotland, the first signs of that cold weather arriving. Some pockets of frost by dawn and increasingly some sleet and snow showers up over the hills at first, but we'll see that sleet and snow getting to lower levels as the day goes on. Through the central lowlands, a good deal of sunshine on offer. Not much sunshine to start the day across England, a rather grey start. Still some outbreaks of rain here and there, and quite a brisk wind blowing as well to start the day, but at least to start the day, it'll be on the mild side. Down to the southwest, again, a lot of cloud, and Devon and Cornwall May well stay fairly cloudy throughout the day. A pretty grey start also across Wales, a little bit of rain here and there, and a similar story across Northern Ireland. But both Northern Ireland and Wales should slowly start to brighten up. Let's zoom out then and run through the day and watch how the cloud tends to break up. The map changes colour. A good part of England, Wales and Northern Ireland will see some sunshine coming through. Increasingly though, the risk of those wintry showers in the northeast of Scotland and across the extreme east of England. The far southwest of England staying fairly overcast. Here, still quite mild temperatures up above double figures, but elsewhere temperatures actually falling through the afternoon. Despite that sunshine, it really will feel very different on Friday afternoon to recent afternoons. Now, temperatures falling away further on Friday evening. More of those wintry showers getting into eastern parts of England. Some sleet and snow showers getting into Norfolk through the evening. And quite widely, temperatures falling below freezing by Saturday morning, as low as -3 or -4 through parts of Scotland. So a cold start to the weekend, of course, thanks to northerly winds. And these northerly winds will continue to bring the threat of sleet and snow showers right the way down the extreme east of both England and Scotland. For many, though, Saturday, yes, it will be cold, but there'll be a good deal of sunshine around. But look at those temperatures, no higher than about 2 or 3 degrees for most of us. Still chilly on Sunday, some sunshine here and there, but signs of a change with some more clouds, some wetter weather and some milder weather returning to the northwest. Goodbye for now.
Next tonight on BBC One, we meet a Hollywood great.
This Christmas, homemade will once again reign supreme. Fresh shall conquer frozen. Succulent can overcome scrawny. And one man shall tempt us to fresh waters, whilst another freezes from tasteless turkey forever.
My Christmas wish would be that everyone tried to buy local food as much as possible.
Saviours of our festive feasts, Rick Stein and the Food Heroes, Monday at 9 on BBC Two.
Piers Morgan, Rosie Boycott and Al Murray Pub Landlord. Yes, this week holds an end-of-year spectacular in 40 minutes here on BBC One.